Right, we're always in the same place here, walking together in the wow. So this is where we're at here. This is the practice, actually. And we just have to do it. There's no way around that. Now, of course, we're told that everything is already perfect. So nothing needs to be done. And any effort or practice only gets in the way of this already apparent perfection. But we're not actually stuck like that, because the realization that we don't need to do anything produces this wowness, like, oh my gosh, this is fantastic, this is wonderful, and it's too much for us, the good news. So we can practice getting used to the good news. You see that? So there's a tendency to, when you read these high teachings about the truth, to feel it's just hopeless. What can I do? I'm supposed to stop all effort, don't try, and you know, it just leaves you hanging like that. But we're not stuck like that. We already know that there's nothing we need to do. However, we do have this continuity issue, continuity fear for one thing, because we're afraid of just how wonderful our situation actually is, because we're not used to it. And there's this overall wowness that, wow, I can hardly believe how fortunate I am. I mean, I'm completely fortunate. So we're really getting used to absolute, perfect good fortune that goes beyond even that. So we do have to acclimatize ourselves to it. It's kind of like we're on the summit of the mountain and we've fallen asleep believing we have to climb the mountain. And then we start to realize that we're already on top of the mountain. We're just dreaming that we need to climb it. And but we need to kind of open our eyes bit by bit by bit, because it's such a relief to us. It's such a relief that we don't know how to, you know, we need to get used to this relief. Oh, it's just tremendous, and it's better than we ever thought it could be. And so this presents an actual kind of, you know, barrier for us. So we can practice in this way, where we're not stuck in theory, in dogma, no matter how exalted it is. But we do indeed do need to practice this way. If we don't, we will feel stuck and hopeless. So our situation is not hopeless. So we're not in too much of a hurry here, because the whole point is to marinate in this good news. So we keep bringing the good news up, we marinate in the wow of it, and then sort of convince ourselves to take a look at the good news again. It's called flipping the script. And then we marinate in the wow of that again. And this is the practice that we have. And at this point, the practice is the guru. Okay, we already know, we can easily explain the truth of the situation. It's just, you know, there's various ways, words you can use and phrases, etc. But one way is to say that, well, what we say here is that we, spirit, wanted to be greater than God. This is not a whim, it's an idea. I said, hey, I wonder if I can be the prime creator. So what we did was we imagined effort and practice in order for the mind to spontaneously produce display, appearance, ornamentation. We imagined this the result of effort and practice. Okay? So then we said that this effort and practice is actually producing reality, is enabling reality to function. This is the position that we took. So then we said, we're prime creator, because we're the ones who are actually causing all to arise and subside out of our effort and practice. So we think we're greater than God in this way. Now, the problem arises when we realize this is all just nonsense. There's no causative link whatsoever between our effort and practice and the nature of mind and the natural capacity of mind. So we say, oh, okay, so all we have to do is let go of all our practice and effort. However, since we've been believing for so long that reality is caused by our practice and effort, when we start to let go of it, what is our fear? Well, of course, it's obvious. Our fear is that reality will cease to exist. So that's why we're so frightened to let go of all this patterns of, we call, practice and effort. So it's a pretty obvious stumbling block, isn't it? We believe the practice and effort is causing reality, which is our way of believing we're greater than God. So to let go of it then would mean that reality would be uncaused anymore, and there'd be just nothing but absolute annihilation. This is a totally logical conclusion based on the premise that our efforts and practice are actually causing reality, right? If that premise was correct, then our logical conclusion would be absolutely true, wouldn't it? So we need to look at the premise. You know, are our practices and efforts causing reality? And even when we see that they're probably not, we're still quite jittery and nervous to set them down, right? Absolutely we are. Understandably so. So let's not be too high and mighty and dogmatic with our theorizing here when it comes to the actual practice of relaxing our practice and efforts. This is a very sensitive matter. Very sensitive manner. So you have those who are very good at theorizing, and they paint the broad picture and say, hey, everybody, you don't need to do anything, and you know, that's it. This is the answer. But they may not be so good at practicing and dealing with the actual fear that we all have, you see. And then they're ivory tower. It's easy to throw out pronouncements from an ivory tower. But the fact is, because of this problem we have, thinking that our practice and efforts are what causes reality to be reality, of course we're terrified to set them down. Along with the continuity problem of simply being unfamiliar with how wonderful it is when we do set it down. So this is a whole different situation. So you have different types of help on the path. You have the theorizers, which are helpful to help us see the situation. And then you have the ones that help us practice, actually practice. And that's a ragged situation, to say the least. Because no matter how much theorizing you ingest, the trepidation still remains. Which is evidenced by when we do take a glimpse at truth, this wow, you know, factor comes up, this reaction comes up. And we have to gently, gradually, you know, evaporate it and dissipate. It's more of an evaporative process. And we can get very jittery when we go too fast, and we can want to rush back into our defensive maneuvering and posturing, you know, very easily when we feel, you know, threatened like this. So don't lose hope, don't despair when you read some theory that all seems nice and neat and tidy is written out there, and say, oh yeah, okay, I don't need to do anything, all practice and effort only gets in the way, it's counterproductive and all this. Don't despair and say, oh wow, there's something wrong with me because I don't feel I'm able to leap into the, you know. not all practice is counterproductive. Getting used to the truth that all effort and practice is counterproductive, that practice is not counterproductive. In fact, it's very productive. So there's a pragmatism which is more important even than the theory. In other words, what actually works is, that's the ultimate, isn't it? What actually works? So you cannot, you reach an end point in theory, right? You follow theory and you see, oh, okay, yeah, all effort and practice is totally unnecessary. Reality is not based on that at all. So, and any efforts we make are counterproductive. And you reach this end point in theory. And if you stop there, you stall out. You stall out. So what has to happen is this leap of faith, which is going into what's called fourth phase practice. And this is, we practice the all-readiness of it. And we keep asserting that I'm already, free. I'm already enlightened. And then experiencing the kind of wow of this recognition, and then letting that evaporate and kind of get used to it. And this is actually effective practice. So we're no longer trying to get it theoretically. What we're saying is, I already get it. I already get it. I already know that I already know. I already know that I've already gotten it. I already know I'm already enlightened. I already know there's nothing I need to do. Yes, I already know that there's nothing I need to do. And then get used to having faith in this, let the feeling arise. So our culture is sort of stalled out. The world sort of stalled out spiritually. We've gotten so much theory, and the practice has lagged behind, as it always seems to do. Theory seems a lot easier, right, than sort of the difficulty of spending time and being patient with the wow factor here. So of course you can act as if you got it all together, but if you just stick with theory, and you can throw out this spiel about how we don't need to do anything, and everything is already reality is already functioning perfectly, and it's easy to say it, but the actual practicing of realizing this and abiding in this requires this actual practice and discipline and patience of full stop in the wowness. This three phase practice that we have here of assertion, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. So this practice will brings us to actual realization instead of theoretical pontification. And keep in mind that those who are adept at theoretical pontification, oftentimes they remain so and don't realize. For whatever reason, they have a gift, and this is what they do for this lifetime. So don't expect the theoretical pontificators to necessarily be the teachers of walking together in the wow. Don't expect them to do that necessarily, and don't expect them to be realized. Actually, don't wait for them to be realized. There are some who have this gift of clarifying theoretically and pontificating upon that, which is fine. It's helpful. Okay, but just don't hold them up as thinking this is the ultimate, and no, it's not. those who are actually practicing are actually in a higher situation, much higher. The phase four practice is you know, higher than the theoretical pontificators, much more so. You can't even compare it, because we're saying, yeah, I already know all this. This is all true. I already know it's already so, and I'm already there. I'm already not practicing. Yes, I already know I'm already not practicing. Yes, I already know I'm not already not making any effort. And from the standpoint of theoretical pontification, this produces some sort of, you know, terrible paradox that they conceptually cannot seem to, you can wrangle over it forever, which is ridiculous. It's not a contradiction at all. It's simply pragmatism of how to get it done. Is you have to acclimatize yourself to this because of the issue of familiarity. And see, the issue of familiarity can never be tackled conceptually. Can never be tackled. So conceptualists simply ignore it. They ignore it. If you, all the books you've ever read, have you ever heard, ever had it where the problem of familiarity is front and center and said, this is what our real problem is? Never. Never do you get that. Never do you get that. Although Jesus in A Course in Miracles did actually point that out, that that's our real trouble. So there's always exceptions to the rule. Because what can you do about that conceptually? What you can do is you just go on forever and ever and ever with words, words trying to remove words. You know, it doesn't work well, does it? So we're all assuming there's something wrong with us, that we can't figure it out through the words, through conceptually. That's because our problem is one of familiarity. Which can never be resolved conceptually. It has to be resolved experientially. And so there's a fundamental canyon between theory and practice here, actually. And the theorist can never occupy the highest mountain, so to speak. And they really cannot be running the show. When it comes to practicing, they have to take a back seat. Absolutely have to take a back seat, because they're very prone to over-conceptualizing the whole thing. They're pacing just the whole way. You know, it gets in the way. Gums up the works. So here we have a different pace. We spend time, you know, cooling down in the wow. We don't theorize the truth so much. Sometimes, well, we do in the flipping of the script part, but so the theorizing has a place in our practice, but it's just one of three areas of in our practice, three areas of importance. First is the assertion, second is the full stop in the wow, and the third is the flipping the script, where we do theorize and clarify to get back to the asserting. Now, in our modern paradigm of academia, we are way out of whack, out of balance in terms of how do we succeed and get ahead and achieve and get the things our desires crave in this world? Through money, of course. How do we get the money? By having good, high-paying jobs. How do we get high-paying jobs? Through getting a degree from a prestigious university in a good area. knowing the right people and fitting in with them, okay? And they knowing that you have got this degree and say, oh, you're an alumni of this. Oh, I am too, you know. And so they say, okay, I can trust you that you're going to have the same values as me. Come on in to our firm. This is how we do it. And how do we get the good grades and how do we go up the ladder of academic success and preparing for high-paying jobs? By being successful at reading quickly, regurgitating what you heard and what you read, concepts where we have to become adept at this. Nowhere in the academic structure is there any emphasis whatsoever on full stop and the wow, or on simple positive assertions. Full stop and the wow. Okay, nowhere is there any of that. So the world, the modern world, is believing that it can get it through books, conceptually. And you can't. You cannot get it that way. And so what they do is they make an idol out of however far they can go conceptually and say, okay, this is it. And then that becomes their context for everything else. And they structure society and civilization around that. I call it the dawn. I call it the dawn. And what we assert here is, I don't need the dawn. I already have the day. I don't need the dawn. I already have the day. So we're practicing getting used to the day, not getting used to the dawn. Or not making an idol out of the dawn, as if that's it, that's the finish point. What other conclusion can those who are trapped in excessive conceptualization and the idea of attainment, success, and all this? What else can they conclude? So it's a systemic problem in this world. It's a systemic problem. Totally systemic. It has to do with, the severity of our delusion that it's biting us. And it looks like there's going to be another cycle, the way things are going. Yeah, because when you make an idol out of the dawn, all concepts can do is bring this faint dawn-like experiencing to you. You think you're seeing, you might be seeing a little bit of lightning in the far horizon, and you say, oh, yeah, okay, that's as far as it can bring you. It's as far as it can bring you. And so, if that's all, then you're going to still put great weight on bodies, things, which are really practices and efforts. Actually, this whole world is really a practice and an effort that we have imagined, that we're pretending is necessary for reality to be real. As if the dance of appearance within pure spaciousness, as if that dance of appearance is actually upholding and causing the spaciousness. You see, it's completely backwards. We have this so backwards. We think all of this is actually, if without this there wouldn't be any pure spaciousness. Well, that's not quite right. The appearing and experiencing in pure potentiality completes reality. It doesn't cause it. So we have this fundamental confusion between completion and causation. Because pure potentiality without any choosing of experiencing, of out of this pure potentiality, choose to experience this, or this, or this, or this, whatever. If there was none of that, then it wouldn't be complete, would it, pure potentiality? So God, which is God the prime creator, is the pure potentiality. And that pure potentiality expanded itself, so to speak, into choosing experiencing out of the pure potentiality. And that chooser of experiencing is what we call God the Spirit. And so this God the Spirit does complete reality. The fullness of reality is there. But it doesn't cause it. It doesn't cause the pure potentiality. It's not causative. It's not causative. It's completative. And that's probably a new word, but we can use it. It's completative. Not causative. It's completative. So, and it's completative not in the sense that it has to remain, but in the sense that we need to be experiencing, having some experiencing in order to, for God, the fullness of God's creation to be what it is. So there's nothing specific that is completing. It is merely everything that arises is this loop of completion. So we're in this, what, flip the script phase here of explanation. So what we do is we sort of bounce between, you know, assertion, wow, flip the script, explanation like this. All three of those are being woven together here. And this is how we practice in the fourth stage, which is the already-ness. I'm already here. I don't need to arrive. I already know I don't need to arrive. I know I'm already here. I already know I'm already here. So we can't not experience. That's not possible. Realizing God is not exactly the goal, because what it is to drop the misinterpretation of our role as spirit. Okay. Drop the belief that we're causative, that we're causing first cause. We're not. We are simply completing it, so to speak. We're the completion of it. That's why we exist. That's why God created us. It's a creation that adventurously chooses experiencing out of pure potential. This is what God is always urgently pressing us to experience, 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 experience. And this is what we're naturally, this is our natural disposition as spirit, as spirit. But we have gone into believing that we can do a type of experiencing which is called practicing an effort, which we believe is actually causing pure potential to be pure potential. Okay. And so we understand that this type of flipping the script also leads to a wow. You see, both assertion and flipping the script explanation, both can lead to the wow. So it's, when I say there's three phases, it's not necessarily 1, 2, and 3. It's 1A, 1B, 1C, or just 1, 1, and 1. Where the assertions can lead to the wow, and the flipping the script explanation can lead to the wow, right? And the wow, we can go out of the wow into assertions or into flipping the script. Either way. So this is the flexibility. It's a flexible type of practice, actually. But you have to connect at this practice at the level of awareness of the wow. And the capacity to do this is not gender specific in some at all. It's not one gender's better than the other at all. It's not the kind of feeling that you might say someone is better at that, being in touch with their feelings. It's not like that. It's deeper than that. The corollary of being over conceptual is being overly in touch with your feelings, actually. That also it can be a barrier, because this wow goes beyond that too. It goes beyond conceptualization. It goes beyond sensationalization. So there isn't really any advantage that anyone has, actually. It's a willingness to do it is the advantage. And you get different types. You get people who over-conceptualize it, and when they get this wow, they don't realize it, and then they just keep going conceptualizing, trying to, you know, deal with it that way, and you can tell that that's what's going on. And then you get the others who have this wow feeling and don't recognize it, and they get into their emotions and their emotions and their emotions. They're weeping, they're crying, they're I feel this way, and they're just all bouncing all over the place. That doesn't do it either. And, you know, painting with broad strokes, you can say there's differences between the yin and the yang, okay, but every person has a plays out in their own, you know, plays out in their own mix that they have. Everyone has their own mix like that. I experienced this one time. I went to see the teacher, one and only time, and this well-known teacher, and there was a group of people there. And people were asking questions. There are different approaches. Some were, you know, trying to conceptualize, and there was this one lady there who, she just said, "What about love?" She said, "What about love? What about love?" And he said, "Yeah, that's great." Then she goes, and I just feel, you know, it's all love. I have to feel love, and she just would not let go of that. And just was struggling with this love. What is love? Love. And that's it. That, you know, that could not get anywhere other. So she was like, you know, stuck in that way. That was quite an experience. And others, you know, that's an extreme example. And others will get stuck on, you know, concept. Yeah, it's always oneness. Always oneness. Yeah, I'm not constant. See, that's stuck there. So here we don't get stuck. We don't get stuck like that. We're aware of this. I call it the wowness. The wowness, which is primary. Okay, it's primary to our experiencing, because what the wowness really is say, wow, I'm not stuck at all. I'm already unstuck. Yes, I already know I'm already unstuck. I don't have a single problem at all on the path. I'm already off the path. I'm already done with the path, actually. I'm already perfect. I'm already the perfect guru, actually. I'm already ideal. I've already got it. And we believe this. We have faith this is true, because it is true, actually. And this brings up a different situation that is neither this, you know, over-emotional or over-conceptual. It's really neither one. It's not either one, actually. It's kind of like, huh. Wow. That's what I like to call it, wow. Just like, wow. I don't know what to say or feel about this. It's just, wow. And so just sitting quietly in the wow, like this. this precludes other reactions, and we begin to realize we don't need any reactions to reality, do we? We don't need to conceptualize it. We don't need to emotionalize it. We're already floating in it. Everything is already floating in pure spaciousness, isn't it? Everything is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already equally floating in spaciousness. Okay, so what we do when we're flipping the script and we're conceptualizing a bit, what we do is we take this conceptualization and flip it, flip the script into what? Positive affirmation. Positive assertion, with positive faith, that yes, I already know that everything is inherently equally floating in pure spaciousness. This is a quality that we all have in common. Everything has this quality in common. There is a common ground of being in terms of all appearances, all experiencing, and that is everything is equally floating in pure spaciousness. So yes, I already know I am already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that I'm already floating in pure spaciousness. Now, so this practice is not something you're going to find with professors or most spiritual teachers or something. They get up on the stage and they give a talk and everybody listens really intently, you know, and says, and they tell you about, you know, all this great theory and wow, great. We don't do that. We don't do that. This is force-based practice. What we do is we easily flip, when we're working on conception, we flip the script back into assertions, back into assertions, back into affirmations. So we turn the explanation into an assertion and then practice it. Practice it. So you might have something like a traditional, I don't know. But anyway, that's what it is. I don't want to compare it right this moment. Not too much. We're having too good of a time right now. Again, when we flip the script, working on flipping the script, we'll suddenly say, hey, that would make a good assertion. When you feel, hey, that would make a good assertion, then assert it. That would make a great assertion, then assert it. And then in asserting it, then the wow comes up. Then the wow comes up. Yes, I already know that I'm already, everything is floating together. We're already all together in this floatingness of pure spaciousness. That we're already one in this floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know we're already all one in our floating and spaciousness. So this is primary. This is the primary condition of all appearance, display, ornamentation, experiencing, is that it's already, inherently, all equally floating in pure spaciousness. This is the ground of beingness, the feeling of ground of beingness as far as appearance, display, and ornamentation goes, is that it's always so. It's always so. That tree is equally floating in pure spaciousness, as is the ground, as is the world, as is the sky, as is the body, as is the computer, as is cans and bottles and rugs and floors and tile and ceilings and walls and lights and roads and cars and oceans and tree, you know, forests and you name it, rocks, everything, debris of all kinds, everything is already equally floating in pure spacious. So yes, I already know that everything is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. And so we work here, we practice, and we build up, we keep working. Assertion, a little wow, flipping the script, assertion, a little wow, flipping the script. Maybe the wow, back to flipping the script. Maybe the wow, back to the assertion, like this. And gradually we build up this spiritual buzz where it gets more and more intense. And then eventually we realize that the wow is just really, really strong. And at that point we start to cool down the whole practice. We start to wind it down a little bit and let things settle down. One way that I see of relaxing the mind, release your thoughts, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go, is what do you feel? Well, you may feel this floatingness, but an equal floatingness. It's not like you'll start floating up in the sky, okay? It's that you'll feel that everything shares this floatingness with you. It's floating in pure spacious. Everything is floating in the very same seamless pure spaciousness. With the exact same zero density, so to speak, zero dimensionality. And so we might feel this oneness with everything, this intrinsic oneness with everything. All is one. And this would be some sort of experiencing, this feeling that we're having, which is not affected one way or the other by whatever our appearances, however our appearance is appearing, right? However we're dancing has nothing to do with the fact that we're totally floating in pure spaciousness, no matter how we're dancing. And everything, no matter how anything is dancing, the ocean, no matter how the waves dance, right? This is a metaphor or simile, whatever it's used for. It could be both. For pure spaciousness is the ocean, and how all the waves are dancing, and yet they're all really part of the ocean, so to speak. It's not an exact. They're all perfectly supported by the oceanness. Okay, all waves are perfectly supported. Doesn't matter how they dance. So it doesn't matter how we're moving and talking and appearing and whatever, we're all, no matter what we do, we're still perfectly floating in pure spaciousness, as is everything right now. Everything is this way right now and has always been this way. So yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Now, I do have a suggestion. We have this practice, and then there's also this japa practice, our continual looping practice we have of, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This practice, I find, is most effective when you wake up early in the morning, I believe. This is what I've experienced. Whereas this sort of practice that we're doing, this three-part practice, this three-phase practice, three-aspect practice, is better. When we're awake, fully awakened, we're focused on, and the day is going, we're really focused in that way. At least this is how I've seen it. Although it's a good thing to keep this, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. It's a good thing to keep it going all day, all day, all day. But it seems that when one is able to use this, well, I find it when I wake up early in the morning and then use this, like sometimes I wake up at 4 in the morning, 5 in the morning, you know, and I'll just use it as much as possible. And I may fall asleep a little bit, and then I wake up again and I use it, something, maybe for hours and hours and hours. That seems to work well. Whereas this sort of careful, you know, these three areas here of this dance we're doing here, it seems that it's a lot better done in this format of when you're fully awake and functioning in daytime or evening time. That's how I see it now. But I imagine you could do it also. When you wake up early in the morning, too. I haven't specifically tried it, I don't think, yet. But I may have been doing it for years and not realize it, actually. But I don't think I was using the assertion part of it. Probably over-conceptualizing. So I'm starting to feel a strain build up, this strain, this wow. And we don't try and describe it any further than just the wow. Okay, this blocks emotionalizing and conceptualizing. See, both. You want to block both at once, in one step. And so we just say, this is wow. Walking together in the wow is that's as far as we describe it. And anyone who is willing to take a glimpse at the actual fact that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness, and to assert this with faith that it is true and feel that yes, this is so, and I'm right on the brink of experiencing this, you're going to feel this wow. You're going to feel the wow. You're going to feel like a reaction. For sure. And then you'll know what we're talking about. And then you'll, quote unquote, as has been often used the term, you'll get it. You know, you get it. Oh, but you get it. There's more than just say that, oh, this is the wow. It's full stop in the wow is a practice, is a discipline, is a determination. It's very tough. Don't project forward, sideways, backwards. Don't spin off thinking about it. What am I going to do with this? Oh, what am I going to do when I'm successful? And you know, don't dissociate, detach from it, like saying, okay, oh, now I got the wow, so now this is going to help me succeed. And what am I going to do when I succeed? And what am I going to say to people? And how am I, you know, before you know it, you're completely out of it. So you just stay here calmly, knowing that you're going to be able to flip the script back into asserting. That's all. You're not finished. You're not finished with asserting. You're just taking a little break. You're not done with the workout. You took a wind sprint, now you're catching your breath, but you're not finished with the workout. That's why you need a coach there, right? Because the people who are working out, they always, you know, at some point they say, I want to quit, I'm tired. The coach says, no, you're not done yet. What do you want to make the team? You're not done yet. It's amazing what we can do when we want to make the team, isn't it? And we want to make the team of those who are already accepted that they're already realized. That we want to make that team. And so we have to work out. You see, there's no way around it. So in workouts, like let's say you want to make the football team or the whatever team, basketball team, or some team of some sort, is the coach says, okay, everybody's got to do these wind sprints, and you do them, and do them, and do them, and do them. And the coach says, okay, all right, take a little break, and then, okay, we're back, now we do it again. And some people said, oh, are you kidding me? Wow, this is just... And the coach will say, hey, you know, who wants to be on the team? You know, if you don't want to be on the team, you drop out. You know, the games we play require you to be in tremendous shape. I can't have you on the team and run you out there if you're out of shape, because that's going to affect all the other teammates. So, you know, you have to keep working at it. And this is what a coach helps with. They have the leverage. You know, the coach has leverage, saying, come on, you know, another lap. I'm going to do another lap. What can the people say? You know, they say, ah, forget it, coach, I'm tired. The coach says, well, okay, sorry, but you're not going to make the team. That's why you see these young people, and they're working out and just looking at it. Wow, they're really giving it their all, you know. It's very impressive. Because they want to make that team. And so why should we be any less impressive than young people who can be very impressive in their will to make the team? Why should we be any less impressive in our will to make the big team, the one that really counts, which is those who you know, truly recognized and truly realized and are truly abiding in the non-dual completionness of reality. Not causeness, but completionness. And so who've dropped all pretense, you know, dropped all pretense of self-delusion. That's the big team. That's the big team. So we want to make the big team here. And how can we hold ourselves to rinky-dink standards of I did a little bit and that should be good enough? I mean, how can we even imagine that that's sufficient? So just because we get into some wow, that doesn't mean that we're done. Just because we made a lot of progress yesterday doesn't mean we're done. It means that we're doing a good job and we're starting to get in shape. Yeah, it's a good start. So yes, I already know that everything is already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Now, the wow is a discipline, because there are some who will instantly convert this wow into some sort of a profound emotional experience. Oh my God, I feel this breakthrough. I'm so full with love and all this. And, you know, they can go on and on and on and on like that. And there are others will translate it into some great conceptual breakthrough. So, oh my God, I can see that how time and space and now doesn't really, you know, this is what happens. And this is what, in fourth phase, we avoid either one of those. We say, oh, I'm enlightened. Okay, had a great breakthrough. Okay, full stop in the wow. Oh, I'm feeling great love. Okay, great. Full stop in the wow. I'm feeling the oneness. Great. Full stop in the wow. Because we're told that this realization is extremely peaceful, calm, peaceful. It's not some super emotional experience. It is not some super conceptual experience. So those are not it. Those are not it. So there's no point in going that direction. And space is also floating in pure spaciousness. Everything is all already floating in pure spaciousness. Without any direction to go in, all directions are floating in all directions. You can say it's floating in all directions at the same time, or zero directional floating. Everything, yes, I already know that everything is already zero directionally floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already zero directionally floating in pure spaciousness. No matter what, how anything is moving or not moving, it's already floating in a zero directional way in pure spaciousness. So it's not a question. Pure spaciousness is never a question of moving or not moving. The delineation of moving and not moving is samsara and nirvana, to use East Sanskritian terms. Nirvana means without going, without moving, without moving, without traveling, without going anywhere. And samsara is the you can say it's the motion and the going places and the activity and all this kind of stuff, but the not going anywhere relative to the going, that too is effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness, the zero dimensionality of pure spaciousness, zero directionally floating. Zero directionally floating, or omnidirectionally floating, meaning the pure potentiality is there to move or not move. And for instance, the space that we see is there so that we can define moving, isn't it? It's sort of the backdrop of moving. If there's a tree over there and I'm here, if I go to the tree, I'm moving through space to get to the tree. So space is part of the dialectic of moving, isn't it? But that space itself is inherently free of that dialectic. It is zero directionally or omnidirectionally floating in pure spaciousness, as well as all apparent motion too. And so we're feeling a wow from this, a wow. We're getting down to the nitty-gritty. See, wow. I don't know if I'm ready for this. Wow. Okay, so this feeling, I don't know if I'm ready for this yet. Feeling. And we can just, okay, don't need to do anything more with that. Just we can say, oh, yes, I already know that all is already floating in zero-dimensional pure spaciousness. Because actually, space is actually a concept. Time, space, process, form, those are all concepts we're having, actually. Nirvana is still a concept. It's like space without motion in that space. But that is not the same as pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness sees both motion activity and the space in which that motion activity is the same as far as equally floating in pure spaciousness. So yes, I already know that I am already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that bird is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I know all this area is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I know that the space is equally floating in pure spaciousness with me and with the trees and with everything else. The atmosphere is equally floating in pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness is an idea, you see. But we don't want to get too academic with this, so what we want to is to focus on the assertions and the wow. Balance it out. Okay, balance it out here. Not too much of one, not too much of the other. Cool thing is of this, we're all, everything is all equally floating in pure spaciousness. Everything is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Is that we see, oh, we're floating in it, but the atmosphere is also floating in it equally to us. See, we're used to thinking that the atmosphere is somehow more floaty than we are, you know, but actually everything is equally floaty in relation to pure spaciousness. Everything is already equally floaty in relation to pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already equally floaty. Nothing I need to do to make it so. In fact, there's nothing I can do that can change this in the slightest bit. Whatever my actions are has no bearing upon changing this fact at all. And this is forever so. So I'm already in an eternal condition. Everything is already in this eternal condition. Yes, I already know that everything is already in this eternal condition. Yes, I already know that everything is already in this eternal being floatiness. Yes, I already know that everything is already in this eternal condition. Now I got an intense reaction at the root of my nasal area, and then it started to spread throughout. And this is where we try to suppress the sneeze, you know, and you absolutely can when you recognize this is a reaction to what we're doing here. it can be easily converted into a sneeze. And what we want to is not do that. Something to do with releasing some sort of patterns from the overall breathing apparatus that go up, and somehow they end up involving the nose too, because you know, a lot of times we breathe through the nose. Actually, the nose is an integral part of our breathing, and I've found that this fourth stage practice, it is releasing these subtle patterns of breathing, something involved with our breath somehow. And this is why you get sometimes a sharp pain in your tracheal area, or irritation, you know. I've had problems with that for sure, that affect my breathing, absolutely. Because actually the body is being breathed. The body is not breathing, the body is being breathed, actually. The so-called, what we call life force in the body, is not actually in the body. The breathing is happening to the body. The life force is more in the breath, in the breathingness of breathing form. You know, breathing life into form, like that. It's not really life, but it's breathing activity into form. Breathing, you know, a dance of appearance, display, ornamentation. In. So, as we work on this, the various constrictions that this breathingness has put on the body, so to speak, can be released in certain ways. This is how I've experienced it. So you may get a very severe tingling and itching in your nose, or some, you know, like something like that, and you just stay full stop in the wow. It's the mind that is imagining breathing. It's imaginary. It's all imagination. So the mind is breathing the body, which is also just an imaginary. It's all imaginary, but we certainly did not work on the breath or try to modify it or do anything about it. It's just occasionally you'll notice these reactions that seem to temporarily be a minor disturbance. So we're in a little wow phase right now in this video. I'm feeling we have opened up an area which is tremendous. So of course we're going to feel a wow about this. Let's be honest with ourselves. This opening up of this equal floatingness is a gigantic leap forward. Occurred to me yesterday evening, I believe, as I was working so hard to full stop on the wow and not doing much of anything, suddenly it occurred to me, hey, everything is equally floating in relation to spaciousness, isn't it? Yeah. And you can say floating because there's absolutely nothing that anything needs to do to be that. It's already that entirely. And so the idea of floatingness is that it's out of our hands, you know. If you're just floating in the air, you know, no matter what you do, you're still floating. Like imagine the astronauts out in space, and they're, you know, Does anything they can do, does it stop the floating if they're out, you know, taking a walk in space? No. Or in their capsule with non-pressurized, whatever it is, zero gravity. In zero gravity, you're just floating. And it doesn't matter what you do. You're already floating. So everything is already has this zero gravity-ness in relation to pure spaciousness. Everything. Already, right now. That wastebasket sitting there, you know, on the ground, the wastebasket, that has it. The debris scattered all over the place, that has it. Stones, in stonework, you see stonework, that has it. Concrete, that has it equally. Sky has it equally. Tree has it equally. Metal, things, paper, cardboard, grass, bark, dirt, rocks, water, all water, everything we see, this plant, greenery, foliage, it's everything is already equally floating in this pure spaciousness. The zero gravity-ness, the pure zero dimensionality-ness. Pure imagine zero gravity-ness, everything would be, you know, floating. There's a reaction in my throat. Oh boy. That's what I was talking about. Okay, I got a little out of sync there. It hit me. Wow. That's often still there. It's like right down in this area here. Sometimes it can get so bad it interferes with your ability to speak at all. So, this is just the ego leaving town. Ego's packing its bags. This is what happens. The ego's packing its bags. Practice. So, yes, I already know. Yes, I already know that I am already floating with everything in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already floating in pure spaciousness. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, it's interesting that you can see in an audience, someone's talking, whatever. Are the people really into it and attuned and disciplined, etc., or not? And there's a whole bunch of coughing all over the place. You know, sometimes coughing. That means people are reacting egoically too much. Ego's coughing, trying to disrupt their hearing. And and disrupt the whole situation. When you're really focused and you're really there and you really want to do it, etc., then that ends up suppressing this reaction, coughing. Now, apparently my mind slipped off tangentially just enough to bring about this reaction. So it's a sign that somehow your mind is slipping off track a little bit. It can be. And you certainly want to suppress that coughing and try to deal with it by adjusting your focus, your attention. So I can go back, when we're at like this, I can go back to, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And we can try to smooth it out like that. Try to smooth it out. Starting to brighten up here. So bring it down somehow. Okay. Well, it's certainly still there. It could also mean a little more patience in the wow. A little more patience in the wow. Maybe was pressing too much conceptually, so a little more patience in the wow. That's probably what it was. And maybe in talks, when someone's giving a talk, the people coughing, maybe they're saying, hey, I need some full stop on the wow right now. Of course, professors aren't going to do that. They want to impress you on how much they know. So they want to use every second to, you know, full blast you. So maybe they're saying, hey, cough, 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 cough. I need a break. I need a break here. I'm already into the wow here. full stop in the wow. Let it calm down, because this is such a tremendous topic to look at. You know, maybe we've looked at it enough for this video. It may be the case, right? It's almost a revolutionary, you know, just a novelty. It's like, wow, we're really not used to this. We're really not used to this. So we have to take it easy here. This is getting a little too close to home. Or we realize, wow, this is very close to home. Wow. Okay, that's fine. So we can back off of it. I need to myself, you know, because it's new to me too. It's like, wow, this is walking together in the wow. This is I've not considered this before. I only considered maybe myself floating, but I didn't consider that all is already equally floating, inherently so. And this is the ground of we could say the ground of oneness. It's a perfect ground of that. All already has the eternal life in this way. We can experience that right now. We can recognize this right now, can't we? Absolutely we can. And so this carries a powerful wow to it that maybe conceptually we don't understand so well, but just being honest, you say, oh wow, this is big time. So let's acknowledge that this is big time. And so respecting our unfamiliarity with the big time, being honest, okay, you say, hey, let's just take it easy in the wow here for a while. Let's not be in too much of a hurry. Now, I did get this morning, I was asking for clarification about, what do we need to do right now? And the clarification was that we need to pick up the pace, go faster. That's it. And I said, what should I do today? Where should I go? You know, just stay put. Don't do anything. Just stay put and tape, and pick up the pace. So by getting into this floating equal floatiness of everything, that's certainly picking up the pace. That's like you're going on a conveyor belt at the airport and you step on another one, it's going twice as fast. It's going so fast you can't even do the backward walk anymore when you see it, you know. You can't even do the backward walk anymore. You try to walk backwards, just make your like you're standing still, and you're still going fast forward. You know, like wow. So we're used to being able to back off a little bit. You know, we're on a conveyor belt, and if we want to walk backwards, we can seem like we're standing still. Whereas if we get on this conveyor belt, no, can't do that. So this is a different pace, for sure. So I'm finding there's definitely a desire to walk backwards on this one, to backtrack on it a little bit, right? Because the ramifications are so extraordinary. And yet, it's so extraordinary. It's going so fast toward the extraordinariness is inherently pulling us so fast. We can't really backtrack fast enough. So this is where we have to use our discipline, our seriousness, our sobriety and seriousness. See, the path is a serious endeavor here, because we're getting into quicker and you get into quicker and quicker paces where you can't backtrack so effectively. See, when you start out on the path, you want to be able to backtrack, and you're backtracking all the time. Say, is this it? No, I don't better backtrack off that. You tend to be very reactive, like a cat or something, where you see something that annoys and you react first and then look secondly. And so you backtrack. You want to be able to backtrack a lot, so you don't want to go too fast. And gradually the pace picks up. And now the pace that we're on now, you can't really backtrack. As I call it, it's a reversible. Yes, I already know that my realization is already irreversible. Yes, I already know that I'm already irreversibly realized. Yes, I already know that this practice is already irreversibly successful. Which is true, right? We're looking at success and we realize it's irreversibly successful. Yes, I already know that this practice is already irreversibly successful. Yes, I already know that this practice is already irreversibly successful. So the whole system here is reverberating right now. Yes, I already know that this process is already irreversibly successful. Yes, I already know that this process is already irreversibly successful. Try not to disassociate from this. Try to full stop it and not disassociate. It's not that easy. Yes, I already know that this practice is already irreversibly successful for me. Yes, I already know that I've already irreversibly succeeded at this practice. With this practice. Yes, I already know that I've already irreversibly succeeded with this practice. Yes, I already know that I've already irreversibly succeeded with this practice. So here's a perfect example of when they theoretically say we don't need to practice. I say, yes, I've already irreversibly succeeded in realizing I don't need to practice. Yes, I've already irreversibly succeeded in realizing I don't need to practice. Or yes, I've already irreversibly succeeded in realizing I don't need to realize. One moment, please. That's a nice little pause button. It gives you a little pause, too. Ants all over, right? Always ants everywhere. They too are effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness as they go about their business. As is everything the ants are walking on is also simultaneously effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already simultaneously floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already simultaneously floating in pure spaciousness. How are we doing on this recording? I'm pretty good. Yes, I already know that everything is already effortlessly. Yes, I already know that everything is already simultaneously and effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. How do you divide that one? Yes, I already know that everything is simultaneously and effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is simultaneously and effortlessly already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is simultaneously and effortlessly already floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already simultaneously and effortlessly already floating in pure spaciousness. And let's not underestimate the potency of this. We're not familiar with this yet. So, uncharted territory, be a little cautious. I don't want to overloop this, overemphasize it until we get familiar with it. Coming up with that pause button, so to speak, going to blank screen, blank sound, has been a real blessing. I hadn't thought of that before, really, but it works great. It doesn't stop the video, but it when these interruptions happen, I'm able, you know, to just deal with them and then come right back. So that's great. So this is the discipline that we have, is that we go into new territory when we pick up the pace. We go slowly. Even though it's a very urgent time, we still go slowly here. So that we don't end up backtracking. The ants are just, they just wander into the keyboard or the computer, down into the computer, you know, they're all wandering around there. They're probably saying, wow, what a weird city that I just discovered down in here in the guts of the computer. The motherboard is down there, all those various things, and they're saying, wow, it's all hot down, it's hot down here and humid and hot and weird place. And then, any food here? No, okay, they wander out. I guess ants are eternally optimistic that they're going to get lucky. They have to be, right? They're searching. They say, I know I'm going to eventually bump into some food somehow. And who knows, there may be some crumbs down there, right? Stale crumbs. Which might be a bonanza for them. So, the sitting here quietly like this is actually a very important part of our practice and path, is the discipline. We've just gone into something that is truly astonishingly important. And we understand intuitively, we understand that this could be, you know, is crucial, crucially important. And so it may be so big we don't even want to admit the wow, for fear the wow is going to be too strong. So we may be in that kind of situation now, where we have this sort of wow of wow, I don't know if I can handle the wow of this great breakthrough we've had here. So we sit like this cautiously, quietly. Give it some time like this. This is one of the keys of success. Because of course you're going to be shifting speeds and going faster, ever faster on the path as you get closer. And you're not sure, like, how's this going to be? What is this going to be like? What kind of wow reaction am I going to have? And so we're a little bit cautious, which is takes discipline, doesn't it? We're not professing too much here. So this is how it really works. This is how it really works. This is not some theoretical opining, you know, from an Ivy Tower. This is how it really works. Is we have real concerns, and we have real hesitations, and we have a need to tread cautiously here. Part of the courage of being able to look at something like this, this issue that's so important, is the confidence you have in yourself that you have the discipline in your own discipline, the confidence you have that you won't go too fast, that you will go cautiously, that you will have the patience, that you will full stop in the wow. This is what gives you the confidence to take a look at this, you know, issue that is so tremendous. Otherwise, you might just give it the briefest glimpse and then spin it off into conceptualization or something. Back away from it. So again, here is that why this practice works, is the more you discipline yourself, the more you impress yourself, the more deep down you have confidence in yourself, and you're willing then to take a peek at this and take a look at it, take a good look at it, look at it directly, and really see it, and then knowing that you're back off from it, and you'll stop in the wow of it, and you won't press it too much. So this is why you know this path succeeds. You end up developing confidence in yourself, in your discipline. You end up trusting yourself. You trust yourself more and more and more, which then enables you to take a closer and closer look at the real heart of the situation, right? Knowing that you're certainly going to get a wow reaction. Trying to figure out here why ants go in one direction and another, and why do they decide to go here and there, you know. We're not trying to figure that out here. Just full stop in the wowness. We realize, oh, we've just opened up a door here, or opened up a window. We've just opened it up. on this consideration, right? And the ramifications are obvious to our mind. So the mind is saying, hey, you know, can we handle this? Can we deal with this appropriately and not come unglued, not backtrack? Okay, basic discipline, hands to hands. I just had this itch on the arm. I was going to scratch it. I said, no. Very bad habit to get into. Because then your mind will see, oh, I can distract myself this way. More distraction. Severe modesty, hands to hands. Severe modesty, hands to hands. A little sip of water if you need it. Don't slouch, don't goof off. That's it. Severe modesty, hands to hands. Don't slouch, don't goof off. A little sip of water when necessary, okay? This is the basics. Very simple. We're not in a university lecture hall here, because if we were, the students would be walking out and they'd complain to their advisors and their parents and say, hey, you're paying my college tuition and everything, paying my freight, and the professor, all the professors just decided that they're going to be quiet for about a half an hour because the topic matter was heating up so much, we need to cool it down a little. And it says, hey, I need the credits for this class. I need to be able to pass the test at the end of the road, and this isn't helping. And, the professors, they can't do that, can they? It's all about efficiency and production. So how can you teach this in an academic setting is the question. We're all too product results oriented, and efficiency orientedness towards goals of satisfying our cravings. And this is going in the opposite direction. We don't need any results, you see. We're already floating. Everything is already floating. Everything is already spontaneously and effortlessly floating in pure space, spaciousness. We don't need to get any results. We don't need to do anything to obtain any result. It's already so. It's already so. It's not possible for anything to be greater or lesser in this regard at all. Everything is already spontaneously, simultaneously, all together as one, already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. It's not that some are and some aren't. That everything is simultaneously this way. All is already one this way. What's our taping? We're at 144. Beautiful, we're at 144. There's the practice number again. Look at that, I look it down and there's 144. I can't see it. It's in bright reflectivity and darkness there. It's in blackness with reflectivity, and I have to, go in real close to try and see what it is actually. And there was 144. 44 meaning successful practice, right? Also can be relate to Turiya, the fourth state, in Advaita Vedanta, the fourth state, There's the waking sleep, sleeping sleep, and deep sleep. Three types of sleep. Three types of unawareness. And the fourth state is awareness, true awareness, no sleep. Could be relating the four practice to for the fourth state. And I say this is fourth phase practice, actually. This is practice for the fourth state, which is neither waking, sleeping, nor deep sleep. Neither waking sleep, sleep, or deep sleep. Rather, all is already, simultaneously, as one, and effortlessly, already floating in this floatingness, in pure spaciousness. This everywhereness presence, floating in this everywhereness presence is equal. It's like floating in space, just, you know, it's like that, as it were. So everything is already this way. We don't need any results. We don't need any attainment. Everything's already in this mode. It's always been in this mode. Nothing has ever attained this floatingness. It's already, it's already arises in this mode. There's no other way it can arise. And to the extent we conceptualize birth as not floating, we can say everything is already completely unborn. There's nothing ever been born into non-floatingness. Nothing can ever be born into non-floatingness and pure spaciousness. It's impossible. So everything is eternally unborn in terms of our conceptualization of bornness. Of anything somehow losing this inherent isness quality that's already present. It's impossible to lose it at all. No matter what, how we practice, and our practicing and our efforts are not what's creating it, because if that were so, our practicing and our efforts wouldn't be in it. It would be generating it. There has to be some prior generation of it to say we're causing it. So we're believing that somehow this thingness is somehow, what isn't, there's something that is not floating in pure space, outside of it, somehow generating it, causing it. This isn't true. See, whether these ants find food or not, they're already floating, effortlessly floating in this pure spaciousness along with everything else. Whether they find anything at all, whatever they find or don't find is the same. Whatever they find or don't find is the same. So you could say, in this regard, everything is the same. There's only the sameness taking place. And this is why we can say there's nothing taking place. And this is a statement in regard to our conceptuality. But there's nothing taking place. There's only the sameness. And is sameness taking place? Is it, you know, there's just the sameness. Everything. There's only the sameness. Yes, I already know that there's already only the sameness. Yes, I already know there's already only the sameness. Yes, I already know there's already only the sameness. Now this puts some more burn into the situation, does it? Some more wow. Wow can feel like a burn, kind of a burn, like it's a deep burn or something that is just is heating up. You know, something's heating up and like electrical wire getting hot, and you can kind of slight smell to it or something. You know, it's heating. You say, oh, this is heating up. The wires are heating up. It looks like this ant actually came across something. It thought it was a crumb, but it turns out to be a non-starter. The wanderer. So this is really heating up, the sameness, bringing up this issue, topic of this, the sameness. Yes, I already know that there's only the sameness. All is the sameness. Now a little bird is here looking at me. It shouldn't be looking at me. It should be looking for cats. Because there's a cat around here. Don't look at me. Don't look at the cat. Look at the cat. Example of misplaced attention. See, I'm not any threat to the bird, so it should just say, okay, there's no threat there. Let me make sure there's no cats around here. So whether the ant finds a crumb or not, it's all the same, isn't it? The sameness. Everything is still floating in pure spaciousness. Exactly as it was, exactly as it is. In that regard, nothing's happening. Nothing is happening in that regard. It's always the same, always the same, always the same. Yes, I already know. It's always, always the same. Yes, I already know. It's already always the same. Yes, I already know. It's already always the same. Yes, I already know that all is already always the same. Yes, I already know that all is already always the same. Yes, I already know that all is already always the same. There's only the sameness. Yes, I already know there's only the sameness. Whether that ant finds a crumb or doesn't find a crumb, both the ant and the crumb are already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. If the ant doesn't find the crumb, same. Both the ant and the crumb are already floating in pure, effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. If the ant does find the crumb, same. They're already both effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. So sameness, sameness, sameness. Only the sameness. Yes, I already know there's only the sameness. Yes, I already know there's only the sameness. Put our faith there. Not our intellect, but our faith. Yes, I already know that there's already the sameness. Our intellect sparks it, but our faith has to be there and combust, you know, and say, yes, I already know that there's already only the sameness. Yes, I already know that there's already only the sameness. This is generating a very powerful wow, for sure. Coming on strong, as the song goes. Yeah, it does. It's building. I liken it to eating hot peppers. It doesn't seem so hot at first, but once it starts building, you realize, wow. Got some heat, has some capsaicin in it. So kind of like you go into like a Major League Baseball park. And wow, you get in there, wow. You know, it's just, holy cow, look at that field. And you're up a ways away from it, of course, and only the rich folks can get down close to it and your seating and stuff. But let's say it's like before the game and somehow the ushers let you go down there and for some reason or they're inattention or somehow. And you get down real close to the field. In fact, you're in the front row and you're on the wall and you're leaning on the wall. And like the field is like right there. And that's just like, holy cow, look how lush and green and neat and this field is like super. I'd really like to get out there, you know. This is a wow. So we're really close. And then maybe there's like a little gate there in the wall they have that, you know, where you can actually go onto the field. And so what do you do? You push the gate and see if it can open. Oh, it's not locked. It's open. So you open it up a little bit. And so now you're standing there and you're just like one step away from stepping onto that field. Okay. And so you realize, wow, I'm just one step away from stepping on this field. Okay, but you don't do it. You realize the gendarmes will come and whisk you away if you do that. At least that's what we believe at this point. We believe it because we want to believe it. Because we think if I step onto that field, there's a whole different ball game. I'm no longer the spectator, you know. And now I'm it. I'm the spectated. I'm the spectated. I'm on the field. So it's a shift of perception, isn't it? So we may want to, you know, fantasize, oh, if I step on this field, then the gendarmes are going to descend upon me and whisk me away and what we may do is we might like put our toe there and put it in the dirt and say okay and then take it back and look, any gendarmes, anybody anywhere, any security is going to get us? No security, okay. And bit by bit by bit by bit by bit we ease onto the field. Each time, check and see, no security, okay, good. Because really, all security is in our mind. And if we get too afraid, we'll call the security, and the security will suddenly appear, you know, like that. And so we have to be cautious here. We don't want the security appearing, because then it'll frighten us back in the stand. So we want to go a little bit by bit by bit by bit here, very cautiously. And remember, I managed to completely dispel a severe arachnophobia that I had. It took me about a year. But you talk about knowing how to go cautiously, bit by bit by bit. That's the ultimate there. That was really something. Couldn't go too fast, or I just quit and say, no, I can't do this. It's too much, too dreadfully frightening for me. But I don't want to go too slow because I say it's so tough, difficult. I don't want it to last too long. I don't want to drag out too long here. So you're in the middle of this dynamic. You don't want to go too fast, and you don't want to go too slow. So I, you know, it was good training for the spiritual path, wasn't it? So I certainly am aware of this and have successfully, you know, done something like overcoming a very, very severe phobia. And this really what we're dealing with here is even more severe phobia. Extreme phobia that if we give up our practice and efforts and step onto that field, that the field will vanish and we'll be annihilated. This is our this is our phobia, and that's the ultimate phobia. So it does take this balance of don't go too fast, don't go too slow. It does take this mix of that. Now, one thing we can do is we can step on the field and immediately turn around to the fans and act like we're signing their autograph. You know, say, okay, here's your autograph. So, oh yeah, I'm one of the players on the field, and this is how they interact with the fans. Act like you've already been there. So this is the key. We're practicing like we're already there. We've already been there. So we know how to act because we've already been there. So when we step onto the field, we don't like look around like a cat on a hot tin roof, saying, "Whoa, whoa, whoa! What am I doing here in the field?" And the gendarme's coming, you know, coming for me. He's like, "I don't belong here. Whoa, what am I? I'm crazy. Why am I doing this?" No, then of course that's gonna panic you. You'll panic yourself. So what we do is we step on the field and immediately pivot to the our friends that are there, our fans, and say, "Hey, would you like my autograph? Or you want my autograph? Okay, great." And you know, so they take, get a hat. They give you a hat. Take the hat and sign the hat and give it back to them. And you're laughing. You're pointing and saying, waving to someone up there. And they're yelling your name. You know, saying, "Hey, yeah, all right, great." And so you know, you act like you've already been there, and done this. I already know how to handle this. Yes, I already know. I already know how to handle this. Yes, I already know how to handle this. Of course. And you'll be talking with someone like this, and you walk down, you know, you wave, and you're smiling, and like that. And then you gradually get used to being there, and you're not calling the security to whisk you away. So we have to be very careful as we step on the field to have the right attitude. So yes, I already know that everything's already floating, effortlessly floating. Yes, I already know that everything's already effortlessly floating. Of course. Yeah, of course I know this. What do you think? I don't know this? Of course I already know this. And maybe you walk down to the bullpen and open it up. Say, "Hi guys, I'm the new guy that's been called up." And introduce yourself to everybody. "Nice to meet you. Thrilled to be here." And sit down in a seat there, you know. Because it's all your own play, really. And so you just tell everyone that, yeah, I'm now the one that is down here on the field. I'm the new guy, new gal in town. And thrilled to be here. Can't wait to get into action here. You know, like that. You don't immediately take part in what's going on. Maybe, you know, you're just going to sit back and take it all in. And you're part of the group now. You're part of the group. See, you just say, "Yeah, I'm part of the group here." Keep a low profile. And you say, "Yes, I already know that everything's already floating." You see, everything is already floating. All is already floating, effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that everything is already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. I already know this, yeah. That's why I'm on the field. So the already-ness is so important, the already-ness is so important. This is what has to be practiced. You have to get on the field, and you can't panic when you get on the field, so you've got to practice. I already know. I already know I'm already a knower. Yes, I already know I'm already a knower. Yes, I already know I'm already a knower. That everything is already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know, I'm already a knower, that everything is already effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. So, yes, I already know, I'm already a knower. Yes, so practice this with faith. Yes, I already know, I'm already a knower. Now, this is bringing up jitters, for sure. Trepidation. Very audacious statement. That was my nickname when I was young. They referred to me with a nickname for the audacious one, because I was so audacious, and they said, wow, you don't want to be that audacious in this world. They thought they were doing me a favor by saying, whoa, tone it down. You're too audacious for this world, at least for this culture, But that's not a big deal to be too audacious for this culture. I mean, pretty much anything you say is enough to turn them into jellyfish, you know? Just a little audacity is enough to send them shaking and quivering and collapsing. Like, oh, I'm not sure what you're saying, you know, about that is necessarily on a real firm foundation. What? Oh my God, my whole world's collapsing. How dare you? You can't say that. It's so audacious. How do you, you know? It's like you're walking on eggshells here at all times in this culture. Who wants to live in a culture where you're perpetually walking on eggshells with no forgiveness, zero tolerance? You got zero tolerance policy, walking on eggshells at all times. What? And of course, you're supposed to be bleeding at the same time. This is the best possible place there is. That should be the everybody gets in the morning, and we all say that, you know, and assert this in unison 20 times. Which is pretty much what we do. Yeah. Skating on the thinnest of ice at all times. With zero tolerance for any any breaking through the ice. Oops, zero tolerance. You're flushed. You're off the island. Everybody here is so eager to vote someone else off the island, right? Out of fear that they themselves may be voted off. They want to preempt it and say, no, we're the ones who are voting you off, that kind of thing. And this is that attitude we have now here is like, if we get the sick authorities after you and vote you, then they're not, they can't be so busy with me. And once a culture gets into this mode, it disintegrates. It happened to the Bolsheviks. And then ultimately they ended up eliminating themselves. They'd sick all, you know, they'd rat out their friends, make sure they didn't get it. But then someone else would rat out them to make sure they didn't get it. And before you know it, nobody was left. It's you know, it's, oh, so-and-so said something very audacious, counter-revolutionary. Oh my God, the whole thing's going to fail because, okay, got to get rid of them. So it's very easy to be audacious here. I wasn't thinking that I was so audacious. I was just being myself. Speaking directly, speaking honestly, but oh my gosh, you know, the whole culture is running on marketing and advertising and stuff, and crafting these fragile images and self-images and all this kind of stuff. So you can't just be blunt and speak the direct truth and everything here. No way. Everyone has to be a timid diplomat. Except those that are screaming at us to be more timid. And they can indulge their ferocity, you know. That's why everybody is so suppressed here. We want to be able to be, you know, be a little audacious. And so the only outlet is to be denouncing others and telling them how un-PC they are and how terrible they are, that kind of thing. Oh, a little bird showed up right on a leaf there. And then it saw me like, whoa. Those little birds are, that's too audacious for me. Whoa. It flew real close, looked at me and said, what am I doing? What am I doing? I'm getting too close. Back off. Did it, and it flew backwards almost. It was funny. All right, so we're cooling it down here. We're cooling it down. Reminding ourselves of how important it is to practice ain't it awfulness about the culture we're in, where, you know, any little movement, you know, you're rocking the boat way too bad, and then throw them overboard. They're, you know, they're a boat rocker. But we here, you have to rock your boat. So you rock your own boat big time by what we've done here. And carefully, you know, careful, and you got to go fast, but not too fast. But the motif is now pick up the pace, pick up the pace, pick up the pace, which is what we're doing. We're into this equal flow, effortless floatingness, and sameness. Everything is that's already the sameness everywhere. You don't have to establish it. Don't have to establish anything. It's a recognition, not an establishment. It's a recognition, not an attainment. It's a recognition, not an achievement. It's a recognition, not an accomplishment. It's a recognition, not an alignment. It's a recognition, not an accomplishment. It's a recognition, not an accomplishment. And gone over the 210 mark, haven't I? Oh well, so what? Got some nice light patterns going here in the background. Let's see if we can what we can do with these light patterns. Oh, that boom. That knocks them out entirely. That means they're not so good there. I don't know what I can do. No. Just is what it is. They're a little bit different. Picking up the pace here, picking up the pace. And so when you pick up the pace, you also give yourself some time to slow down. I mean, to relax into it, right? I mean, I imagine if you got on one of those trains they have in China now that go, how fast? 300 miles an hour or something? I mean, wow. I've seen video out of, you know, one of these trains as they're going through the countryside. I mean, if you get on one of those trains and you're looking out the window, your heart's going to be racing. I mean, your mind is going to be reeling. If you're not used to it, right? For sure. You're just not used to the things passing you by so fast at all. You can look up that on YouTube, Chinese super trains, super fast trains or something. And yeah, it's astonishing, really astonishing. Wow, you go over bridges, just like you're flying. You're going 300 miles an hour, however fast they're going, it's like flying. But you're on the ground. So, wow. That's a wow. So we're going here super fast now. We've picked up the pace super fast. And we need to get used to it. But I'm sure once you get used to it and settle in, have some nice food and conversation, and you know, gradually you can get used to that speed. I'm sure of it. Gradually you can get used to that speed. Otherwise, nobody would ride the train very much, would they? So, we can gradually get used to this increased pace? How do I bump this up? I don't know. Yeah, we can get used to it. And we are getting used to it. We are getting used to it. The first step is to introduce it. That's the first step, is to introduce it. And then successfully have a successful introduction. And then you start to say, oh, okay. Yeah, I can do that. I did that. It wasn't so bad. I can get back to that. I can revisit that. I can engage with that. Be careful in your cool down with this, and take it easy. Take it easy, because we just really picked up the pace. And inside you might be a little woozy from it, just like on one of those super fast trains. After a while you might say, oh yeah, I can get used to this, right? Then I'm doing fine. Pull into the station, get off the train, and walk on the platform. And nothing, you know, you're going 0 miles an hour at this point, you're standing there. And you might just be going, whoa, 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 wow, whoa. Nothing's moving. Oh my gosh. You know, it's like, and then you might realize that you're still, you know, quite shaken up by the experience. So it's like that. You know, we're getting off the fast train. Train's slowing down now as it's getting to the station. So there's a time when you slow down. And then you kind of get used to things passing you by a little slower. And then you get to the station and, okay, you slowly get off the train, very slowly get off the train, and realize that you may be, you know, jittery, a bit shaky after this, and say, okay, that's the price I paid for the experience. That's fine. Go get something to eat. Take it easy. Me, I don't know what I'll do. Check the sports reports, maybe. And I don't know what else I'll do. Try to do as little as possible. Eat dinner. Whittle away some time. Keep saying, I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Keep saying that. And then sleep on it. Good. We've already done a tremendous job here, you see. This is the benefit of these videos, is when you get through, and you've already done a tremendous job. You've already put in tremendous workout. What does it do? Builds confidence. What does confidence do? Builds speed. What does speed do? Builds assurance. It builds more confidence. So every workout you go through, it builds your confidence, it builds your speed. And that builds confidence to do more, because you realize, hey, we really are getting there. This is not an endless task we have. It's not an endless task we have here. It's not a Sisyphean task that no matter what we do, we roll that stone up to the top and it rolls back down. You know, this is what everybody else is experiencing in the world, right? We're not experiencing that. We just realize sameness and equal effortless floatingness, and, you know, we said, wow, yeah, that's getting there. That is really getting there. That stone is not rolling all the way back down the mountain, no way. In fact, we're finished with the stone. We're just on the top of the mountain. We don't even care about where the stone is. If the stone's at the bottom of the mountain, who cares? It's equally floating with everything else, isn't it? We don't have to push the stone up the top of the mountain. It's already an equal sameness with everything else. We don't need to do anything. We don't need to establish anything. We don't need to cause anything, establish anything, accomplish, attain, achieve, align anything. It's already this way. That stone at the bottom of the mountain is already equally floating in pure spaciousness. Whether it's at the top or at the bottom makes absolutely no difference. It won't change it in the slightest bit. No matter where it is, it's already equally floating with everything else. Okay, so I'm just continuing to go here. It's okay. It's okay. Try to get everything we can out of this, because we do need to make rapid progress. We most certainly do. And we're doing just that. And tomorrow I'll need to pick up the pace even more. That's my challenge here. Even later today. Don't give up too early here. Don't give up too early. See, we don't need anything to change in any way for it to recognize it's already floating, effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. We don't need anything to happen in order to recognize this right now. We can fully recognize this right now. This is something we can fully recognize right now. This is fully recognizable right now, this instant, and it applies to everything. It's already the case with everything, and it's already the case right now. So this is something we can recognize right now. So we can be a realizer right now, can't we? We can realize this fact right now. A little bird came down again. And don't look at me, bird. Look for the... It's going for some water. Very cautious. These little birds. Okay, so this little bird, whether it hops here or hops there, doesn't make any difference as far as its floatingness and pure spaciousness. It doesn't change it one iota. Doesn't modify it in the slightest bit. There's zero modification taking place in this world. Zero modification taking place. This very instant, there's zero modification taking place. So everything is here now with this. With the sameness, with the zero modificationness, it's all here now. It's happening right now. It's happening here, and it's happening now. It's happening everywhere. It's happening now. Saw me move and took off. Well, whether it's here or there, it's all the same. So, whatever happens in the world, whether it's this or that, in terms of everything effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness, it's neither here nor there. It doesn't make any difference whatsoever. Zero modification is taking place. Always. Even an atomic bomb doesn't cause the slightest modification. All the reactions, chemical reactions, energy reactions, are all already inherently, effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness. Just as like everything else. Nothing changes whatsoever, ever, with this fact. bring this up because it's important for me. Living on the West Coast, right near the Pacific Ocean, West Coast of the U.S., we grew up in the Cold War, where the Soviets had long-range bombers with nuclear missiles on them. I mean, well, nuclear bombs on them, and submarines, actually. Also submarines that had nuclear warheads on them. And so we grew up with these radar stations all over the place as an early warning system. And we were told, you know, to expect at any moment we could be bombed, with atomic bombs could be dropped on us. This is how we grew up in school. We had these drills, air raid drills. Get under your desk, you know. So we live with this constant, existential dread of nuclear bombs being dropped on me without any real warning at all. Or we might get a brief warning. Well, where do you do? Where do you run to? See, back then, there's all the popular magazines. You had these told you how to dig a bomb shelter that would protect you from an atomic bomb. And so people had all these bunkers and bomb shelters. We didn't have one, so I figured, you know, I'm toast. So every day you wake up and you feel like, you know, today's the day I might be absolutely obliterated, annihilated. But can the floatingness in pure spaciousness be annihilated? Doesn't matter what form there is. Does that change it? If you're turned into... what would you be? Water vapor, mostly. We're like 90% water, or 95, whatever. So I guess we'd be vaporized. I mean, the body would be vaporized. And there'd be some ash from the bone and various... just a little bit of ash, a little bit of vapor, you know. Well, isn't that also 100% purely and effortlessly floating in pure spaciousness too? So the floating in pure spaciousness... this is not subject to modification, no matter what happens to the body. Because it's an equal feeling for everything. Everything has this equal feeling. It's not related to the density of anything at all. It's completely unrelated to density. Absolutely unrelated to density. Therefore, it's unrelated to all chemistry, all... atomic particles. It's unrelated to particles at all. And how dense the particles are, how the frequency of waves forms, it has no effect on it whatsoever. So time, space, process, form has no effect or modificatory effect on the fact that everything is equally floating in pure spaciousness. It's not always. And I'm not doing assertions too much now, because I think we've probably reached a saturation point on that. I'm doing more flipping the scriptness here. Mostly, you have to, you know, just monitor it, sort of. We're already in this new territory, actually. Conceptually, we may have seen the dawn of this, but now we're in the full dayness of it. You know, it's quite a difference. And who needs the dawn when you have the full dayness? Who needs the dawn when you have the day? Who needs the dawn when you have the day? So we're interested in the full dayness of it now. And you need a whole different approach for this than if you're just glimpsing little bits of it, which is the dawnness, which conceptually we may have done that previously, but now we're actually realizing, oh, we're in the full dayness of it right here, so we need this practice, different practice here. And we can recognize that even an atomic bomb has no effect on it whatsoever, and even no matter what we do with atoms or whatever, and science has no effect at all. Science and technology has zero effect on it, will never have any effect on this. whether this body lives or dies has no effect on it. The entire realm of time, space, process, and form has zero effect on this. Modifications in time, space, process, form of appearance have no effect on it whatsoever. Do not modify it at all. There's no modification taking place. Zero modification. Yes, I already know that nothing is being modified. There's no modification taking place. Yes, I already know that I'm in a zero modification situation. Yes, I already know that I'm in a zero modification experience. Yes, I already know I'm in a zero modification experience. Yes, I already know I'm already experiencing zero modification. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing zero modification. So we do a little assertion here. Yeah, yes, I already know I'm already experiencing zero modification. What we try to do with our be severely modest is we also try to, as much as possible, don't express any turmoil or struggle or difficulty, anything. Just stay severely modest, humble, serious, like that. So I made a little face here, to try to stay away from that. Just maintain sort of a neutral expression. Maintain a neutral expression as much as possible. This actually helps smooth out the wow a little bit. If you start goofing off with it and it's going to tend to exacerbate it. And so what we do is say, oh, no, I'm sitting here calmly. I'm sitting here quietly. And expression is calm, neutral. And so this helps me calm down. Helps the wow calm down. No, we're not trying to be zombies. We're just trying to be neutral expression to help us calm down from the wowness of walking into this territory of the fullness of day. Opening our eyes and saying, wow, this is the fullness of the day. It really is. That we're not just puttering around the dawn. We're not just glimpsing the dawn here. No way. We're way past the dawn now. We're way past the dawn. Of course, it's irreversible. Once the fullness of the day is here, you can't find any dawn, really, can you? Now, you might look at shadows and stuff, but the awareness is that the fullness of the day is here. Fullness of the day is here. Another day in California of, like, summer. I'm supposed to go do something at a particular time. But I say, forget it. You know, forget it. It will get done expediently enough. This is too important here. We're not going to just let the world dictate to us as if doing a little chore is somehow more important than what we're doing. There's nothing more important than what we're doing, actually, in this world. I know I'm already engaged in the most important activity. I know I'm already engaged in an all-important activity. Yes, I already know I'm already engaged in an all-important activity. We most certainly are. Seeing the full dayness of sameness and no modification and equal floatingness and seeing all this, the full dayness of this is all important. So I already know I am already engaged in an all-important activity. I already know I'm already engaged in an all-important activity. trouble stopping the wildness here. It's not easy. Full stop on the wildness, it's not easy. Because what we're doing now is starting to think about, what do I do next? And then that takes you out of the wildness. It's not good. Have to discipline yourself not to do that. Yeah, we're taking the situation with the utmost seriousness. I can't even remember the last time I played golf. It's been so long. And, you know, just say, no, I can't do anything other than this. This is all important here. We're engaged in all important activity here. Business before pleasure. Business before recreation. This is all important business we're engaged in right here. And then, of course, I'm trying to think of how to explain it to someone who doesn't get this at all. You know, and you can't explain it. And it's ridiculous. So you just try to avoid getting put into a situation where you're called upon to explain it. A lot of people in this world are not even in first phase practice. In fact, they see not being in any practice at all is a sign of superiority. So how can you possibly, you know, deal with that mindset? It's just try not to think about it. We just keep trying to succeed here. So I already know I've already succeeded. Yes, I do. I do already know that I have already succeeded. I do know this. Absolutely. I already know that I've already succeeded. Yes, absolutely. I already know that I have already succeeded. Yeah, absolutely. I already know that I've already irreversibly succeeded. Absolutely. Yes, I already know that I have already irreversibly succeeded. We're getting a good recording here. It has not dropped out. Full stop. Again, mind was going to the future. That's not good. That is not good. That doesn't help. It doesn't help our situation, because then it really takes us out of, why are we feeling this intensity, actually? It's not because of the future trying to explain to somebody our success. We're feeling the intensity, actually, because we're having success. The success of this, of opening our eyes to the full dayness of sameness. Zero modification. Everything, floatingness, everything equal floatingness. Wow. This is where we're getting the intensity. So we want to stay in touch with, where are we getting the intensity for as long as possible? See here, that's what we're doing. Where does the intensity really come from? And like I said, if you're using, you know, just X drugs, rock and roll, so to speak, that the complex of artificial intensity, this confuses you about where the intensity is coming from, which undermines your confidence. Undermines your confidence. There's a reason why there are rules and regulations in those places that teach the spiritual path, you know, as a lifestyle, because they know you have to build your confidence, and you don't want to do anything that undermines your confidence. And not knowing where the intensity is coming from, what's causing it, is severely undermining your confidence, and so you will stall out. So of course they say, if you want our help, if you want our help, and we're going to put all this effort into helping you and encouraging you, and we're all together, and then you have to, of course, show us that you have the mindset to succeed at this. You're willing to follow the rules that help maintain and build your confidence and don't undermine it. That they don't undermine your confidence. That's why these renunciate orders have vows. They have vows. You have to take the vows. You have to say, okay, I'm so serious, I'm willing to vow that I'm, you know, going to follow these vows. Absolutely. And it's basically just vow not to undermine your confidence. Otherwise, you're wasting everyone's time. So let's stay in touch with the intensity. Where is it coming from? We're now looking at the fullness of the day. It's like we're stepping onto the field here. And we realize that this is now the big time. This is the big leagues. What we're addressing right now is the big leagues. There's no question about it. So that's why we're feeling it. And so we don't back off. We're spiritual marines. We don't back off. But at the same time, you know, we hold our ground for the time being. Hold our ground. Yet the intensity is still there for sure. Where are we at? We hit another 44. Oh, great. 244, 44. Perfect. 244, 44. Practice, practice, practice. That means we put in a very good practice, doesn't it? If you hit the 244, 44 mark, we've put in a very good practice here. Outstanding practice. What does the practice do? Builds confidence. But we don't use this confidence to go back and dominate at some lesser area, you know, with those who are struggling with their confidence and, you know, lesser, we don't go use it to dominate there. What we do is we reinvest this confidence in the next step of going faster for us. Going faster. Opening our eyes more, you know, saying, hey, the fullness of the day is already here. Fullness of the day. I don't need to do anything to establish it. It's already here. I don't need to do anything to establish the fullness of the day. It's already here. This is seeping into our consciousness now, isn't it? Fullness of the day is already here. We've just gone over this. Wow. So this is just giving everyone a chance to, you know, to cool down, to hold the intensity, hold your ground, hold the intensity, get familiar with it, boost your confidence, so you can say, yeah, I'm already confident. I know I'm already confident. I know I already see this. I know I already know. I know I'm already realized. I already know I don't need to do anything. I already know this. I already see this. I've already realized this. I've already accepted this. I already realize there's nothing I need to do. Yeah, it's not easy to full stop on the wow for a long period of time. So that's why I try to loop it back into flipping the script and assertions. Because too long, the wow, your mind will start to wander. It's difficult to hold it there for a long period of time. So this practice is your friend. The practice is the guru. That's how I look at it. That's how I take it. And give the practice respect. Absolutely give it respect. It's the vehicle. It's the yana, the vehicle. Snowplow yana practice. Our vehicle is the snowplow. Snowplow yana. It's an even another division, you know, divisions of divisions of divisions. And don't get caught in, well, how does snowplow yana relate to all the other yanas, and exactly what kind of sequence do you need to go through, and how is this compared to the other sequences, the 100,000 other sequences, and, you know, full stop in the wow. You just say, hey, well, my response is, wow. I'm just going to full stop on that, wow. Great opportunity to full stop on the wow when you start going like that. What is your view on da-da-da-da-da, wow, full stop on the wow? Just hearing the questions enough to wow me. The implications of the questions are just really wow. So much, huh? Gotta stop right there. So I'm just letting it marinate here. We're just letting it marinate, you know. See if anything else comes up. The good thing about 3 hours is it's a long enough time to give you an excuse to eat something, right? Yeah. Usually after a 3 hour focus like this, you know, you can say, you know, it's justified to go eat something. So that's an advantage for sure. Unless somebody came into your yard and started stealing all your fruit or whatever, or something, would you jump up and yell, no, you just keep practicing. You don't break the stream of practice. Stay in the stream. Somebody brings their dog in your yard and they're pooping in your yard, and you jump up and yell, hey, what are you doing? No. I say, I'll deal with that later. Who cares if somebody steals some mangoes out of your yard or bananas or oranges or whatever? Apples, pulls tomatoes off your tomato plants. Whatever. That's not. Don't you don't react to anything when you're practicing. you don't react to anything, unless you have to take a phone call. If you know, but it's best maybe even turn your phone off. I have to leave mine on for a couple of reasons, but don't, you know, don't react to that. Keep your cool. Keep your cool. Don't break the concentration early. Don't break the seriousness. Stay quiet. Don't react. Jesus appears in your front yard. Just, you know, just keep your cool. Just keep sitting here. If Jesus and a band of angels show up in your front, just keep your cool. If all the deities of all the heavens show up in your front yard, you just keep your cool. Because we're doing our practice. We're doing right. The guru's right here. Practice is the guru. So we honor the guru by staying in practice mode. This is the archetypal story of being in meditation and all these demons arise. Well, some of the demons are, you know, terrible, threatening, and others are seductive. Beautiful, seductive demons that say, hey, come play with us. Look how much fun we're having. Come worship us. Come join in, you know, the gods and the goddesses and their play. And the others, the devils and the demons that are, you know, tormentors and frighteners and threateners and boasters, and so it's both the snowplow plows both aside. The snowplow of our practice, the snowplow practice is what we're doing, right? The snowplow practice plows both aside. The temptations aside. So by maintaining this outward reserve, it helps calm down the inner jitters. We're not amplifying them in any way, which is very important, because the inner jitters are certainly there. Even if our awareness is kind of not so aware of it, they're certainly there. When we get into getting into what we got into, this stirs the pot greatly, because we realize realization is near. I mean, it's already here. I'm not estranged from it in the slightest bit. Actually, there's zero estrangement. Yes, I already know. I already have zero estrangement. Yes, I already know that I already have zero estrangement to realization. Yes, I already know. I already have zero estrangement from realization. I'm already zeroly estranged from realization. Yes, I already know that I'm already zeroly estranged from realization. This is already so. Yes, I already know I am already zeroly estranged from realization. Yes, I already know I don't have even an iota of estrangement from realization. Yes, I already know that I already have not even an iota of estrangement from realization. So this keeps bringing up more wow, which is fine. Just do everything we can here. zero estrangement from realization. I already know. Absolutely, I already know that I have zero estrangement from realization. Absolutely, I already know that I already have zero estrangement from realization. Absolutely, I already know that I already have zero estrangement from realization. Absolutely. Yes, I already know. I already have zero estrangement from realization. Yes, I already know that I already have zero estrangement from realization. Okay, this is the essence of our practice. Yes, I already know I already have zero estrangement from realization. Okay, so when you find yourself going through situations in the day and opportunities, remember, you have this great practice of, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And we have this wonderful, you can just keep that going. And this really snowplow so much snow away and enables us to get to this already practice. Absolutely, yes, I already know that I already have zero estrangement from realization. You see, it enables us, it gives us the confidence. It's a like miraculous assertion, a miraculous assertion that has tremendous benefits to us, and innate gives us the confidence, some innate confidence. Then we're able then to get to this really intense 3-hour session like this. So we are indeed winding down here on our last minute. So great job everybody. This is a tremendous confidence booster, getting through this, what we got through in this video, getting through that. Wow, that deserves a huge wow in itself. And we know it. Those who have done it, you know it. And here we go. So we're winding down. We know that we did it, you know, and did tremendous work here. Okay, the final countdown here. Keep your composure. Stay severely modest.